The community in which he was brought up was unique in that it was comprised of Jewish immigrants that had fled from several European countries to avoid persecution from the Roman Catholic Church. The Jewish people, including our philosopher's Portuguese ancestors, traveled from place to place until Dutch authorities granted them asylum. This, as long as they didn't cause any scandal or allow any of its members to cause ripples throughout society. It seems here that it was destined that Spinoza would belong to the world, and in 1656, at the age of just 24, Spinoza would be excommunicated from the synagogue, and the world would be better for it. He would join no other creed and live out the rest of his life alone in the outskirts of Amsterdam. It was here, under the name Benedict, that he would reach out to every corner of the earth and throughout every generation. Our philosopher published only two books during his lifetime, and due to the threat from the Roman Catholic Church, these publications would be anonymous, lest he would suffer the same fate as the tenacious Giordano Bruno. His greatest work, The Ethics, would only appear after his premature death in 1677. Approbation for his achievements would take even longer. In an attempt to maintain clarity, we will cover his work in the order in which he produced them. The Treatise on Religion and the State. He begins by asserting that the language of the Bible is deliberately metaphorical and allegorical. This was in order to capture the imagination of the masses, since scripture was written primarily for an entire people, and secondarily for the whole human race. Consequently, its contents must necessarily be adapted as far as possible to the understanding of the masses. For this very same reason, the apostles resorted to miracle stories. After all, the people will always require a religion phrased in imagery and haloed with superstition. And no matter how many are destroyed, innumerable others will spring up, anxious to occupy the throne. Spinoza would also pause in perplexity at the utter lack of compassion towards other creeds displayed by the Roman Catholic Church. "I have often wondered," he said, "that persons who make boast of professing the Christian religion, namely love, joy, peace, temperance, and charity to all men, should quarrel with such rancorous animosity and display daily towards one another such bitter hatred, that this, rather than the virtues which they profess, is the readiest criteria of their faith." We see here why, in an age dominated by the Roman Catholic Church, Spinoza would publish under an alias. Lastly, this work reveals to us, for the first time, Spinoza's pantheistic view of God. Allow me to pass by his second book, Principles of the Cartesian Philosophy, in order that we may focus on his more original third and fourth. After the many ills of life that he experienced, Spinoza set out on a quest to discover how he might go about attaining the faculty of enjoying throughout eternity continual supreme happiness. And in his third book, The Improvement of the Intellect, he reveals to us what he has found. "To strive for the utmost development of our intellect, while abstaining from all things superfluous, this," Spinoza thought, "would allow for the better understanding of its forces as they pertain to the order of nature. True happiness can only come to us through the pursuit of knowledge, and this pursuit would eventually lead us to the joy of understanding." Throughout this pursuit, he thought the philosopher must also remain a citizen. He lays out these rules of conduct to follow as we seek this elusive end. 1. To speak in a manner comprehensible to the people, and to do for them all things that do not prevent us from attaining our ends. 2. To enjoy such pleasures as are necessary for the preservation of health. 3. To seek only enough money as is necessary for the maintenance of our life and health, and to comply with such customs as are not opposed to what we seek. Before delving into Spinoza's masterpiece, The Ethics, a question that must be explored is, how do we know that our knowledge is knowledge? How, with our senses so often deceptive, do we determine truth? Spinoza suggests that first we must distinguish between the various forms of knowledge, and in Durant's The Story of Philosophy, he assists us in understanding each of them. First, there is hearsay knowledge, such as when I know the date of my birth. Second, there is knowledge that comes about by experience, such as when a physician knows a cure, not by any specific formulation of experimental tests, but by a general impression that it has usually worked. Third, immediate deduction, or knowledge reached by reasoning, as when I conclude to the immensity of the sun from seeing that in the case of other objects, distance decreases the apparent size. Fourth, the highest form of knowledge comes by immediate deduction and direct perception, as when we see at once that 6 is the missing number in 2 times 4 equals 2 plus x, or as when we perceive that the whole is greater than the part. If you're familiar with the works of Immanuel Kant, then you should.